So I've queried Krishna here before the class starts, and he tells me I haven't told you about the following experiment. This, in my way of thinking, is the most important series of experiments ever done in cognitive psychology, developmental psychology, actually. So here's the here's how we get started. There's a rectangular room, if you're a person. If you're a rat, it's a rectangular box. All the walls are painted white. You with me so far? So now, in each corner, there's a basket or a cloth or something under which you can put some food. Now, you put the food there while the rat watches you. And then you give the rat a little spin to disorient it. All right? So then the rat stops and goes for the food. And you can keep track of where the rat goes. And the rat goes with approximately equal probability predominantly to those two corners. So I bet you didn't know that rats were that smart. So they understand the rectangular nature of the room, and they don't go to the diagonal corners where the food cannot be. So are these genius rats? Or maybe we're just rats with big brains, because we do the same thing. So if you repeat this experiment and replace the rat with a small child, and then you put a toy in there instead of food, the child is usually held in a parent's arms, usually the child's mother, usually because they think that if they participate in these experiments up there at Harvard, the kid will get into Harvard someday. So the kid goes to the diagonal corner, just like a rat. And then next thing you do is you try an adult. Maybe an MIT student. In that way, in case you can use food again. And you get the same result. Who could be surprised? So rats, children, and human adults, pretty much all the same with respect to this experiment, until you paint one wall blue. Rats are not colorblind, in case you're wondering. Then what happens? Well, if you paint one wall blue, the rat still goes with equal probability to the two diagonal corners. If you paint one wall blue, the child still goes to the two diagonal corners with approximately equal probability. It's only us genius human adults who go only to that corner. So this invites a couple of questions. One of which is, when does a child become an adult? Any ideas? Leica, what do you think? Yeah, you can pick a number greater than 1 and less than 10. Manasa, what do you think? 5? Pretty good guess. Do you have siblings at that age? It's a surprise, but why is it 5? Is it because, what does it relate to? Is there any correlate to the onset of that ability? You might try everything as Spelke does, because she's extremely careful. So she's tried gender. She's tried the onset of language. I don't know, the appreciation of music, handedness. And there's only one thing that matters. And that is that the child becomes an adult at that time when they start to use the words left and right when they describe the world. Now, I said that very carefully because they understand left and right at an earlier age, but they only have started to use the words left and right when they describe the world at the time that they begin to break this, symmetry and go to the correct corner. Now, for the next element of this, I need something to read. Has anyone got a textbook handy? Ah, here we go. China, illustrated history. Now I need a volunteer. Okay, Andrew, you want to do this? So here's what you're going to do. You can stay there, but you can need to stand up. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to read to you a passage from this book, and I want you to say it back to me at the same time I read it. It's as if you were doing translation, simultaneous translation, except it's English to English. Gosh, this thing's got words I can't pronounce. Okay, you ready to go? All right. When overwhelmed by the magnitude of the problems he tackled, he began to suspect that others were plotting against him or secretly ridiculing him. So it's not, thank you very much, Andrew, that's great. So you see, he could do it. Some people can't do it, at least it takes a little practice. But he did it, and guess what I've done to him? I reduced his intelligence to that of a rat. Because if you do this experiment with an adult human who's doing this simultaneous English-to-English translation, they go with equal probability to the two corners. So what's happened? What's happened is you've jammed their language processor. And when their language processor is jammed, they can't put the blue wall together with a rectangular shape. So it seems to be that language is the mediator of exactly the combinators you need in order to build descriptions. Because they can't even put those things together when their language processor is jammed by the simultaneous translation phenomenon. So that brings us to the two gold star ideas of the day. And one is, if you want to make yourself smarter, you want to do those things. Look, listen, draw, and talk. Because those are the particular mechanisms that surround this area down in here, which is the center of what we do, which is the center of our thinking. So why do you take notes in class? Not because you'll ever look at them before, but because it forces the engagement of your linguistic, your motor, and your visual apparatus. And that makes you smarter, because it's exercising that stuff. Second thing you can say in conclusion, especially from this experiment, is beware of fast talkers. Why do you want to be aware of fast talkers? It's not because they will talk you into anything. It's because when they talk fast, they're jamming your language processor and you can't think. That's why you want to be aware of fast talkers. Because if they jam your language processor, you won't think, and you'll buy that car, or you'll buy that drink, or you do any manner of things that people who want you to do those things have learned to do by talking fast to jam your processor. So that completes what we're going to do today, and we'll give you a demonstration of some of this stuff on another occasion.